Greetings, and we are back. Well, some of us never left, but I'm back. Greetings and welcome to the Badger Cave's West Wing, where our stealthy polecats ferret out the best feels, funnies, and what the fucks to discuss slam bam badger style. Your sinuous hosts for this evening are myself, Supreme Doge in Charge, Polecat Punster Hannah, Max Simpsonskin, not jaundiced, and our anchorilla, Scott. Dr. Renner McCam is going to be taking the day off because I told him to. So, this evening, we will be covering the following topics. Sure, we can try to get rid of old white male philosophers and instead introduce a more diverse kind of truth and logic and reason. But if it's coming from old white male professors, it's still just as bigoted. Also, the Chinese government has recognized a crisis with men and boys in other parts of the world and at home, and they have a plan to save them. But what does this mean? Feminist and social justice warriors eat each other as the feminist anti-Trump Women's March is being accused of being too white and not inclusive enough. Needs more zeers and foes. In an attempt to put all of their readers in wheelchairs due to the back-breaking cringe Olympics, Marvel Comics has released a new comic series entitled The Unstoppable Wasp. Florida restaurant now offers the angel shot to save women from creepers, misogynists, MRAs, gamer gators, guys who lie about their height, guys who look too much like my ex, losers, etc. And finally, our bonus story for the patron-only after show. We were going to do a review of the red pill that was actually not as cringy as they usually are. But in a last-minute change of heart, because of the cringe fest that is the Unstoppable Wasp, we're actually going to go through and read the comic itself with our patrons. And hopefully get a good amount of laughs in mixed in with our tears of sadness. And if you want to
there's
listen...
no shortness of those in that book.
No. Anyway, if you want to listen to this topic or enjoy further personalized discussion with the Badgers on select topics, please consider becoming a patron at www.patreon.com/honeybadgerradio. Now, before we get into said news items, allow me to give you all the latest regarding the case of Honey Badger Brigade versus the Calgary Expo and the Mary Sue, as we have recently returned from there. The good news is that a judge found all of our causes of action had merit, which means the Calgary Expo and the Mary Sue's application for summary dismissal was denied. Unfortunately, due to the extended conversation over semantics and technicalities, by the time the summary judgment was declined, we had half a day left for the trial. The judge who presided over the summary judgment was the first to take an in-depth look at the case, and due to the complexity and scope, he informed us that at least 2 and more likely 3 days would be needed. We were granted November 28th through the 30th, 2017, so later this year, for our official trial dates. We look forward to our next day in court. We will follow up with this story at length on the Thursday show. So be sure to come back on Thursday where we talk more about what happened. Now.
Can I add something in real quickly?
You may.
You know what? Regardless, no matter what happens on November 28th through the 30th, I just want to say thank you to the Mary Sue and the Calgary Expo. Because without them, I would have never talked to Allison and never come on the Badgers.
This is true.
One good thing came of it.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think this is, we'll have to talk about it on Thursday, but I will say that I have a very positive outlook on how things will go with this case.
Can I just interject something before we move on to the news topics?
Sure.
I believe I have something of value that I want to add to this discussion. In addressing Mary Sue and the Calgary Expo as somebody not directly involved with this, I'm only partially involved because, you know, honorary honey badger, I would just like to say this. Suck it. Go ahead, Brian.
Suck it.
There you go.
All right.
And you know, after being on the show this long, it's kind of hard to say you're not a honey badger.
Yeah.
Honorary is gone. You're just one of us now.
You guys are badgers now.
The honey badger Borg has absorbed you.
Okay. Damn. So okay, by saying suck it, is that like gonna vote for you not well legally?
No, it should be fine.
No.
But yeah, we'll claim you.
We'll put all the
now we get to get possessive over you, right? Because
Hey, I'm fine with that.
Welcome to the Honey Badger Borgade.
Before you go out and get them approved before you go out on your date. I don't know about this girl, Max. She's a little bit too forward.
So?
She's a little bit too forward. No, those are just boobs. They stick out like that. It's normal.
Well, the more forward, the better, then.
Is it cold in here?
I'm Indian from clear across the room.
All right, so let's get into the stories. And Max, you are first. Tell us about old white professors.
All right, no problem. And by the way, just in case you were wondering, when he said that Dr. Random McCam is taking the day off, he means permanently. Anyways,
forever.
Apparently,
for the whole you're day.
Fine. You're fine.
So check it out, ladies and gentlemen. Apparently, when speaking on the subject of race, logic is only sound when it is being spoken by a black man or woman. Didn't you know? The seed of immaculate wisdom is coming from an institution that we just so happened to talk about last week, I believe. It was the School of Oriental and African Studies in London, England. In a scathing report from the SOAS Student Union, members criticized the London institution for bearing unconscious racism towards their students and the fact that 60-year-old white men were teaching them. God forbid. In this 46-page long report, non-white students expressed that they felt excluded from classroom discussions and that teachers had made, quote, explicitly racist comments, citation needed. One section in the report said that the fact that authors and teachers were predominantly white sent a, quote, implicit message as to whose perspectives mattered and whom the courses were for. It also said that, quote, non-white students were comparatively less likely than their peers to be able to take or to access the advantages of cultural familiarity with their tutor, and that, quote, some felt it unrealistic to expect their white tutors to be able to empathize with their problems. The report concluded that unconscious bias workshops should be introduced to the staff and that the SOAS should write and publish research papers on its, quote, colonial legacy. Let me take this away.
How do you do unconscious bias workshops? What, how do you do that? How does
you
that
sleep
even...
sleep through the workshop because it's so boring. You know, what these students don't realize is that they have just deeply insulted themselves. Because what they're saying is they, unlike white students, cannot relate to people of other cultures. Like, white students are not allowed to say, well, I can't learn math from this black professor because I don't understand his culture. I don't have, what is it they said, in here, be able to access the advantages of cultural, I don't have cultural familiarity with this teacher or this professor, so I can't learn math from him. I mean, I've learned all kinds of things from professors who came from dramatically different places than I did. I when I took Spanish in college, I learned from a Brazilian professor. It's a totally different background there, and she had, of course, her home accent and everything, and it did not hamper anything, that there was no problem there. So what these people that wrote this are basically saying is, we're not smart enough to do what white people are expected to do. We're not smart enough to reach across cultures and understand people who are not from the same neighborhood we're from or don't have the same historical perspective that we have. And we don't want to learn anything that isn't something we've already experienced, you know, which is sad. That they're depriving themselves of a great deal of new and different experiences. And they're also calling themselves stupid.
Yeah.
You know what the thing is, though? You know what this is? This is going to be something. I'm going to beat this drum probably a couple of more times tonight when we go through these stories.
Oh, but, yeah.
Here's a thing to think about. Humans, well, I don't know, maybe not humans. Oh, some humans. We'll just say some humans. Some humans have, in this present day and age, say in the last 10 to 20 years or so, have this, you know, have this habit of overcorrecting when they see something going wrong. It's like, oh, you know what? A black person stole something, therefore all black people are thieves. Oh no, a white guy said something or did something that was racist, therefore all white guys are racist. whatever it is, it's like there doesn't have to be like a consistent studied effort to understand a pattern or something. It's just one thing just has to happen. And then everything within that subset or that species, that genre, whatever it is then bad.
It's yeah, like, because
all white men are bad. All white men are racist. All white, philosophers. You can't do a thing in school and this, that, and the other.
Right.
There is no measured, reasoned approach to any of this.
No.
And it's like, why don't people see this and understand what the fuck's going on? This is so fucking retarded.
I think in cases when those things happen, the presumption of guilt or the behavior to be normalized within the group that's being criticized in that instance, that's coming from the person. So basically they're basically just saying out and just saying for everyone to hear, I'm bigoted and I'm ignorant and these are my views. I'm waiting for something to happen to galvanize what I already believe. And right. Then I make it sound like it's something I'm responding to. But you're just really just saying what you already think. Like, if you have a low opinion of, well, first off, if you see people as, groups, you already have something that you need to work through, in my opinion, like to some level, when you're basically seeing all women are this, or the women are affected by X, and people of different races are affected by Y, and so on. Well, that's already part of it, because you're not seeing people as individuals. You're oversimplifying groups because it you think it works easier for you. And then on top of that, when you basically make assumptions about groups based on the experiences or events, no matter how isolated, then you're also, it's just lazy thinking, and using it for what you want. Because as you were saying, Scott, let's go with the example that might be used by a racist, okay, against black people, right. Even. I'll do that. If that person has had an experience where they were mugged by a black guy. They will say, this is why, I have low opinion of black people, because this happened. This is what they do, and I know this is what they do because it happened to me, right? No, right. We would all agree that that's, not really, it's too bad that this happened, but that's not really the best way to go about talking about it afterwards. But at the same instance, even this is a one-off instance, okay? And I know I'm putting off, we're going to ignore statistical data, because I know that that's how you get into the nuance. What I'm saying is there are a lot of people who ignore all that altogether, and they just go by their anecdotes, and they use that to pass summary judgments.
For sure.
In the same breath, the same guy, if you showed him, or if he saw like an example of like a black man who, went to college, got a PhD and became a doctor or a lawyer and made a lot of money, then he would not acknowledge that as something that is a pattern amongst that group of people. And the reason why I say this is not because of whatever the truth might be, because this is not about truth. This is about people's biases. And how it essentially they pick and choose what they want to acknowledge and what they don't. So you can take the same situation, flip it, and basically make it a Black Lives Matter, black supremacist person that has opinions about white people and how they're always racist whenever they do anything. And they might point to an incident like, oh, here's an incident where a cop shot a black man. And they don't know any of the facts. Nothing has come in yet, but they've already decided what the reasoning is. Oh, it's white supremacy. Yeah. It's whatever. And so this is mainly because these people have already assumed, they already know the answer to the reason. Now they're just looking for data to support what they already believe.
Yeah. Well, and I think part of it too is, we've seen the rise in the idea of othering, I think. I mean, granted, these sorts of things have happened before, in the past, but I think there's this, it seems like there's this, people have grown to have this, I don't know, I can't think of the word I'm looking for at the moment right now. I'm stumbling. Sorry about that. But,
it's all right.
People have kind of grown comfortable in the idea of othering.
Yeah.
It's become a very common thing to the point where, people don't really recognize it. So, and then that makes it easier for this, all black people are thieves, all white people are racist, all this or that, all this thing is this one thing because of this one time this one thing happened. And it's just, it's kind of funny to me that people don't ever recognize that. At least it seems that way anyway. You know, I don't want to say that nobody does, but it seems that the vast majority of folks are so willing to, like you said, because they have biases, because they have, you know, their experiences are flavored by whatever instances that have happened to them personally, and they let that be the mandate going forward. It's just ridiculous to me because, like, you know, I lived in Savannah when I was going to school down there, and I lived down in the fucking ghetto, and I'd ride my bike to go home to my fucking shitty little apartment, and I'd have black kids on the side of the road throwing rocks at me and telling me to get the fuck out of the neighborhood, you whitey fucking honky, that and the other. And it's like, but then I'd have I'd see white people and they'd be like, oh nigger this, I hate black people, da 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 da. It's like, so I understand that, you know, it's like just the actions of one do not implicate the whole.
Sure.
So I don't know. It's just kind of strange to me that people just kind of like are so willing to just kind of give up on the idea of reason. And you see stuff like that. It's like any reasonable person would read this and be like, what in the, really? What? It's like they would have a spit take almost because it's so absurd. So yeah, I don't know, man. We're living in some fucking crazy times, and I just don't understand it a lot of the time. I understand it, but it's just like, still, it's just like, really, come on now. Have we not grown? It's fucking current year. It's like,
no, yeah. Tribalism is essentially what we're looking at, and I think that I think it's basically like a more regressive, like and simple and almost it's a very simple way of thinking, but I think it's really easy for most people to just use that. And I actually had a discussion with my stapler about this today. We were just talking about it, and it was one thing that I think is going on is there are people who are interested in keeping us tribal because it makes us easy to control.
Oh, absolutely.
And so that's part of it right there. And then there's actually pressure from within the communities themselves to remain tribal. So there are, you know, like you could be people in the black community want to keep other people in the black community from getting out of their situation. And one of the ways they do it is they accuse them of being race traitors. Even if those people just want to move out of the ghetto and like find a place, you know, like basically make something of themselves. And I think that this is something that happens in lots of groups. I mean, you see it happening with feminism too. Women who walk off the plantation are demonized in a horrible, horrible way. So
look what happened to Cassie J.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's kind of the root problem though, is that kind of behavior has become normalized. And that's the thing I don't understand, where like people's brains, their logic centers don't kick in and like, wait a minute, there's something really kind of terrible about this. Why are we doing this? Mm-hmm. It's just kind of crazy, you know?
Because tribalism is sort of ingrained into sort of the primitive side of human nature. And plus it also helps to explain away some of life's more difficult problems. And if one were to ever look be so much emotional distress that they wouldn't be able to cope with it. That's why people, in my opinion, sort of drift towards that type of thinking.
Yeah, and that's how you get stories like this, where people are basically like, they're white men, therefore they don't have anything to say, and they presume that because most professors happen to be older white men, or maybe not even most, I guess, I think that the education system is still pretty dominated by women, but maybe in college there's a shift, because I noticed that I had a lot of male professors. Then that might be true. I don't know what the numbers are, but essentially, in the eyes of the people in this group, that even if it's in the minority, it's too many. And
it may depend too on what area you go into, because the areas that are more, I don't know, dry and factual and stuff, you usually see, like the entire department, the entire math department, when I was at school was all male. There weren't female professors in there, and you see that also with a lot of the hard sciences, that if somebody's going to teach it, it's usually a man. And it might be a generational thing. There might be more younger women coming in as older men retire and everything. And it's oddly enough, the place where I found the most minorities, usually minorities that came from foreign countries, was in the biological sciences related to teaching things you were learning if you were going into some area of medicine, like nursing or psychology. where you had to learn anatomy and physiology and things like that. Usually that's where I seemed to see, personally, when I was in school, that's where I seemed to see more professors that were from foreign countries, other than in areas where they're teaching the language of the country they came from.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I guess we should probably, thanks for that, Hannah. I think we should move on to the next story, though. I was just thinking that we've been talking about this for like 20 minutes. So I'll go ahead and do the next one. This is about China. So
China,
you're not gonna do it. You're really, you're not gonna do it, Brian.
This is okay. It's about China. It's
about China. Come on,
China. Doing the chat all day. China. China. I'm doing the hand gestures. I don't even know why. Nobody can see me. You know where he makes the okay sign. You know, like China. Yeah. So they got the best men. They're fixing the men. It's fabulous. It's great. Anyway, so. This was submitted to me by our assistant, Mike J. Thank you, Mike J, for the write-up. And we have entitled it, We'll Make a Man Out of You. It's the name of the show. As masculinity continues to be demonized and deemed toxic in Western countries, China has taken a drastically different position on the matter. Fears have been arising that young Chinese boys are being sheltered and coddled too much, leading to a feminization of the next generation of Chinese males. With gender identity observed much more strictly in China than in Western countries, this potential crisis of masculinity has many afraid it could lead to societal problems and could possibly even compromise national security. The demasculinization of Chinese boys is being blamed on China's one-child policy, which has since been bumped up to a two-child policy as of last year. The policy led to parents over-pampering and over-protecting their only children, which in turn led them to developing poor social skills and relying heavily on parental support. Another potential cause is lack of male role models, something most visible in Chinese schools where 4 out of 5 teachers are female. Some within the Chinese media are even blaming Korean and Japanese actors and pop stars for having a too effeminate appearance. To counteract... this is what they're saying.
I mean, they're not wrong, but, you know.
Yeah. To counteract...
God damn it, Final Fantasy.
Right?
This came out right after the release of Final Fantasy XV. To counteract this perceived crisis of masculinity, a new school textbook entitled Little Men has been adopted for 4th and 5th grade students. It covers differences between the genders, triggered, as well as the importance of a good father-son relationship, double triggered.
Yeah, because they're going to learn that from a book and not from their dad.
So, does anybody have any thoughts about China?
What do you do with this? I mean, wow.
This is a sort of a mixed bag here, because you've got, it's not bad that they are valuing masculinity, but the reason is because masculinity is a utilitarian thing for them. And it's not because they care about the boys that they're teaching this to. It's not because they care about the families and so on. It's because they don't want to not have what men give a society when these boys grow up and act like girls.
Well, I would say too,
self-centered.
Because I think because of the work ethic in China, the men are not, the fathers are not actually around very often. They're often really busy working themselves to death. And this is
which kind of makes it hard to have a good father-son relationship,
exactly,
doesn't it?
Exactly. If
you get to hear 2 words from your father every day, that's not exactly a relationship.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And on top of that, considering it's communist China, the work conditions that are there, I suppose they would need to sort of hyper-masculinize the boys that they already have so that they can deal with those types of working conditions, right?
Yeah, this is... It's, like I said, it's a mixed bag, because I have a feeling that they are not going to They're not going to teach these boys that masculinity is not a toxic thing the way feminists are calling it a toxic thing. They're not going to come through and say, we value you, you're wonderful because you're boys. You're. It's good that you're here, it's good that you're alive, and the things that we want you to do, you deserve praise for doing them. And they're basically going to teach them, you owe society this because you're male, which is not, it's not a functional way of promoting men's right to be masculine in the way that they choose to be masculine. And is as far as the effeminate appearance of anime and media stars and everything goes, that's kind of mixed as well, because it's not that hard to teach somebody that you can look attractive and still kick ass. Because if you look at a lot of these anime characters, they're fighter types, even if they don't look like they're, you know, a brick wall with hair and eyes. You know, they still are fighter types. You don't have to be Conan the Barbarian to be the toughest guy in the room. You know, and I mean, I've known a lot of guys who were skinny, like really skinny, really, how do you say it, sinewy, real, you know, long, skinny muscles and everything that you wouldn't want to get into a fight with. And it's not like there's one way to be masculine. But if they're trying to teach them adult values for work ethic and, you know, taking things as they are and toughing things out and handling conflict and problems and things like that, it's not bad that they're trying to teach them those things. It's only bad if they're trying to teach them that they have to be disposable for society.
Essentially what they're doing, from what I can tell, is they're concerned that this new generation of boys is not going to be as useful a commodity to the, essentially, the advancement of China itself.
To the state.
So, yeah, that's what it is. It's a communist country, exactly. They need disposable men to go out there and be, the, you know, their wage slaves. And so I think this is, yeah, and basically that what's happening is, you know, because these parents love their kids and they basically implemented a law saying you can't have more than one, well, then they treat that one like it's really precious because it is their that child, but even more so because it's the only one they're allowed to have. So you're going to get these coddled children. And yeah, that's an unfortunate side effect of a bad idea that China had. But on top of that, well, it's a bad idea for a multitude of reasons. But I think that part of it has to do with the more kids you have in a communist country, a country that's striving for communism, put it that way, then that means the more mouths you have to feed through that system. So they don't want to burden themselves. Look, but unless those people are useful to them, right?
Oh, sorry.
No, I was just saying.
We're also talking about a country that does the Sesame credit.
The Sesame credit, yes, yes.
You know, we're not talking about a country that is really. They don't really give a fuck about their citizens. Let's just be real, kind of to the point.
Exactly.
You know, let's cut through all the bullshit. They are very much, you know, in the way that they run things, they are very much still a communist state that is doing things that are at the you know, working towards the betterment of the state. And for the state. So this is, you know, there's nothing altruistic about this. This is not about, you know, supporting men and men's rights or anything.
Like not at all.
That's very much a matter of, like you were saying.
You know, yeah. This is the reason why I use this story, because while on the surface you get this whole, like, oh, they don't like how feminized men are becoming. This is the other end of what's wrong with it. Because it's not coming from a place of compassion for men. It's coming from a place of wanting to maintain men's utility in a way that feminism does not. I mean, like, neither side really cares. But
feminists do this too.
Yeah.
Like, you see them, they'll have article after article after article about toxic masculinity and how unfair it is to men that they have to be tough and strong and, you know, all this other stuff. And then after feminist men start living up to what feminists say that they want men to act like, then you start getting these articles, where have all the good men gone? Where's all the cowboys, you know? Where's my John Wayne?
Or I would never date a feminist man.
Yeah, I would never date a feminist man. Like, all of a sudden, it's well, now they're not utilitarian enough for us. Now they're not doing things for us. They're not fixing our cars. They're not, you know, fighting off the bad guys. They're just standing there being, girly men. And all of a sudden, that masculinity, those aspects of masculinity that feminists called toxic aren't toxic anymore. And those aspects of humanity that feminists called masculine, you know, they don't necessarily not want men to do that. They just want to be able to complain about it. They want men to continue to do it, but they want to be able to complain about it and use those complaints to control men. But they certainly don't want men around them to stop being what they would deem as masculine for their benefit. Mm-hmm. You know, it's only toxic if it's not for them.
Yeah, it's kind of like they hate cops until they need a cop. It's like, God, I fucking hate pigs. Pigs are the worst. Oh, God, somebody stole my purse. Where are the police?
Yeah, I saw a lot of that.
Around when you need them.
A lot of that attitude in high school. It's sort of the thing that turned me on to being a part of this whole community as it is because you see a lot of girls in high school that say, oh, yeah, I'm a feminist. You know, we're paid less, yada, yada, yada. And then there's like, oh, yeah, all guys should be feminists, yet they go for these guys that actually represent these toxic masculinity archetypes.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's because that's what they want.
From there. Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, it's really what they want. I think that,
and of course, a lot of the concept of toxic masculinity is really taking characteristics that are human dysfunction in general that both sexes do, and either treating them like they're only bad when men do them, or only men do them, even though you can find plenty of examples of women doing them.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And suddenly, it's masculinity in the woman too.
Huh.
So I guess we'll move on to the next story, but yeah. Wait, you say masculinity in the woman? Like inside her?
Well, you know, that can be fun, but not if it's toxic.
Yeah, you wouldn't want that. Nuclear peen. okay, Scott, you give us the next one about the anti-Trump Women's March.
Let's see. 3 days from now, Donald Trump will be inaugurated as the 45th president of these United States. In response to this, the Women's March on Washington is slated to take place as the signature protest of this monumental event. Over 100,000 women with celebrity headliners and a feminist message are expected to be amongst the attendees in Washington, D.C. And that's not including the sister projects planned for nearly 150 cities across the rest of the country. However, in a recent turn of events which surprises no one, women planning the march have begun turning on each other instead of uniting in solidarity.
No.
Indeed. Intersectional feminism has once again reared its ugly head and now has white women and women of color at each other's throats. According to the New York Times, surprise! According to the New York Times, a recent Facebook post made by a Brooklyn March volunteer asserted that the march's white allies needed to listen more and talk less, and that while white women are allowed to march, they should be checking their privilege constantly.
Oh, God.
But New York isn't the only place the march is coming apart at, it seems. Other such claims have been made in Tennessee, Louisiana, New Jersey, and Maryland. Even the march's priorities have come under scrutiny as a result of different ways of feminists clashing over which issues should be at the forefront of the event. And while some of the march's leaders continue to beg, can't we all just get along? It looks less and less likely that everything will fall into place for them by January 20th.
Oh, that would be hilarious if they got to the point where they couldn't even do the march because they were too busy fighting over who has the most privilege and where in the line they should be and all that.
Right.
Oh my God.
Backbiting and whatnot.
So
I got to say something directly to our feminist hater listeners about this. You fucking asked for this. You and your intersectionality taking over every civil rights movement that you came across, from different minority movements to the GLBT movement, everything that you could find. You asked for this. Your progressive stack is now falling over on you. We're all just going to sit here and watch and laugh.
Yes.
This is exactly why, like, okay, it's no secret that based on what I've said here on this program and on my channel, that when it comes to women's and men's issues, my advocacy tends to fall more on the women's side because I've been around women more in my lifetime. But it's exactly this reason why I can't ever get involved with any of these organizations. It's exactly this in its rawest form. It's the intersectionality where you can't ever get anything done because you're always pointing the finger at people and trying to say, you're the reason that everything is wrong with my life.
Yep.
You know, it's just, I can't, it pisses me off and it makes me sad because there are legitimate issues to be taken care of, but you can't do anything.
Yeah, it's just like Occupy Wall Street, right? When it started off, it made a lot of sense. Everybody was getting together. They had like a common thing that they all were there for, you know, and then after a while you had people calling themselves ketchup and they were like fighting for rain dance rights and no rape zones and shit. Things that just don't make sense. This is, you know.
Wait, does that mean rape is okay everywhere else?
Yeah, that was the thing exactly. When I heard that, they were literally like, we're going to make some no rape zones. And I'm like, what are you talking about? It's already illegal.
Yeah, don't we have a planet that is already in no rape zone? I mean, technically, like,
I mean, it really? Shouldn't like, be, but I don't know. I guess it's like when you're a kid and you're playing tag and there's like the glue, like the safe zone. You know, it's like ollie oxen free, sir. You can't rape me, and then you know, and then they have to stop.
Swiper,
oh shit!
No swiping.
I didn't know that you were in the rape free zone. I mean, pull my pants back on.
Clearly they need to take this beyond the planet. It's time for a new Occupy movement. They need to actually get their own shuttles together and occupy space.
Occupy Mars. There you go.
Because it's getting to the point where that's just about all they do anyway. They come up with these stupid ideas and then they eat each other alive. They should just admit it and start calling themselves Occupy Space.
We should colonize Uranus and call it a no-rape zone.
There you
they
go.
They need to start occupying.
See, I think you made a clever little pun there, Hannah, without even realizing it. All
no,
they do
I
is
did that
occupy
on purpose.
Space. Did you? Oh, okay. Oh, okay. But, see, I didn't because you kind of walked past it, and I was like, "Wait a minute! There's a joke there. There's a joke there."
Yeah. If nobody laughs, I just move on.
That was the joke.
That was the joke. Yeah.
Tippity toppity keck.
And honestly, if your Uranus is not already a no rape zone, I'm out of here.
Yeah, right.
I know you, Hannah.
Yeah, I just think this is hilarious. If no one shows up, if they can't get their shit together by the 20th, and this doesn't like you know they don't show up, I'm gonna the mini keks will be had. Is all I'm saying. That's what you know. Weren't there like a lot of, as an aside, speaking of the inauguration, weren't there like entertainment industry performers that were threatening people that were, you know, being invited to come and perform at the inauguration? I think Snoop Dogg put out like a threatening message and there was like somebody else too. It's pretty fucked up.
Really?
As an aside. Yeah. Yeah, they were making threats on people that might just, you know, that may have,
idiot.
I don't know how it works, like if you get invited or what, but there were people that were, you know, like performers that might be going there to perform and they were getting threatened. There was one guy who, I don't remember who he was, but he was supposed to go and he actually backed out because of the threats he got, like online and shit. Yeah, like they were threatening his life, his well-being if he went and performed. So he's basically like, well, I'm not going to go. But yeah,
I'm so glad I don't pay attention to the news at all anymore because this stuff would just drive me fucking crazy.
I get you. You're just watching it burn. That's basically what it is.
Well, I'm not even. I've gotten to the point where I'm just like, I just want complete radio silence. This stuff is too fucking stupid. Yeah. It's just like, seriously, man, it's current year. We're not smarter than this. It's seriously, it's 2017 and people are still acting like they're in fucking high school. Get the fuck out of here, man.
For real.
Oh my gosh. Right?
All right.
Come on, y'all. You got to be better than this. Y'all.
It's okay. Just chill out. Have like a date grape and play some video games.
There you go. Well, I think you broke Max.
I'll meet you on Uranus.
The Russian. I didn't do it. Scott, it was Russian hackers that broke Max.
The comments that we're getting right now. You have to wipe out the Klingons around Uranus. Uranus is love. Uranus is life. Knock knock. I'm looking for the no rapes or for the rape zone. we have Ellery Rotten for the Klingons. We have Strontium. I'm not gonna try to pronounce that because I've got it highlighted. But I think it's Strontium X Nitrate. Uranus is love. Uranus is ripe. Terence Crosby, I'm looking for the rape zone, and Antoine Stone, Uranus is colonized.
sing it with me, Scott. You will survive.
Everyone else is doing it. You can try to touch my anus on the inside.
Why do you want to do it on the outside?
Way better than when Hollywood did it. All right, moving on to the next. What? It's true. Moving on to the next story, I'll take this one. Okay, send me an angel shot. That's another music reference. Do you believe in heaven above? You know that one? All right, anyway.
Oh, yeah. It's a gem.
You sound really excited about it. All right.
Just call me Angel of the Morning, Brian.
Send me an angel.
Okay. Fucking synth pop.
Not now.
Okay, I'm sorry. I digress.
All right. Have you ever wanted to discreetly call the cops on your Tinder date? Because now you can at Florida restaurant if you are a woman. The Iberian rooster has the following message posted in their woman's bathroom. So it's the only way you'll see it. Quote, are you on a date that isn't going well? If your Tinder or Plenty of Fish date is your Tinder or Plenty of Fish date not who they said they were on their profile? Do you feel unsafe or even just a bit weird? We're here to help. Just go to the bar and order an angel shot. If you order it neat, your bartender will escort you to your vehicle. If you order it with ice, the bartender will call an Uber or Lyft for you. If you order it with lime, your bartender will call the police. We'll handle things discreetly and without a lot of fuss. We've been there, and we want you to know you're in good hands. No way will this be misused. So,
can I just point something out really quickly here? You're ordering drinks. You're drinking, and the guys that they're gonna get the bartender to escort you to your car after you've been drinking. That, yes. Nothing can go wrong with that. Nothing. Nothing.
Well, that's an interesting question that you pose, but I guess it would depend on how far into the night do you discover that your date is maybe an MRA, which is terrifying a thought, or maybe they're in support of Gamergate, or maybe they just, the shoes just look like he's cheap and poor. Because the thing is, they don't... Well,
definitely merits calling the cops.
Well, I'm saying
the fashion police need to be summoned immediately. This guy has crappy shoes. Come and get him.
Yeah,
he's wearing white after Labor Day. What the fuck is this?
Now I can see
Avenue. What are you poor?
Yeah, exactly. Where'd you get that?
And he's gonna have no idea what you're doing because he didn't read the article.
Yeah, no, nobody could see the article. We're actually not looking at it right now because only the women can see it.
They didn't name the actual restaurant in the article.
No.
So that's not going to blow up hugely.
Yeah, aren't going to go to places where they don't do this and order an angel shot, and the bartender's going to be like, I don't know what that is. Call the cops or something.
Right? But I guess... what I'm seeing is something that came about with every good intention. I think the idea comes out of good intentions. But what I think is really being severely, cannot be understated, is how exploitable this is by ill-meaning women. And so, let's go with the mild version of how this is kind of shitty. If you meet someone on a dating website, like a Plenty of Fish or OkCupid or Tinder or whatever, you're probably I think that in the most optimistic of cases, you'll often have a person who is your first date, your blind date or whatever, and they're really awkward and shy. and, you know, they're having trouble with communication. They're really nervous, and they may, like, do some dumb shit while that's going on. But a woman who might use this service could interpret that as creepy or weird or frightening, especially if she lives in a world that has basically fear-mongered for decades about men. And more, and especially now that we have the internet, that you can find all kinds of, like, you know, fear-mongery shit coming from feminist camps about women's getting raped every day and all of their, how they should live in fear and catcalling is the devil and all this terrible stuff about every man in their life. But at the same time, they're hoping to find romance with the right man, of which they've been told is extremely rare. And it's like a diamond in a fucking mountain in a desert, basically. And,
Nothing more rare than that. It's a unicorn.
It's like trying to find a unicorn. I mean, this is the way that it is, right? Like, this is sure. I think the narrative that's being pushed out. So if you're a woman and you're going on a blind date with a guy and he's a bit awkward, or, you know, he's doesn't know, like, what he's also scared too, because, right, there's, like, guys that are getting thrown in jail because a woman accused them of rape, even if they didn't do it. It's dangerous to date. Dating itself is scary for men and women.
I bet almost everybody listening knows at least one guy who has been actively attacked by a woman he's gone out with too. Like, not just legally or whatever, but outright she's done something to him.
Here, here.
You know, I mean, one of the guys that I dated for a very long time moved far away a few years later, and the next time I heard back from him, he had picked up a gal in his area, and they had gone back to his place, and she was fine. And then she came out of the restroom. She went in the restroom. She came out of the restroom. She tried to shove him out the window. So sometimes you don't even know, you know, when you bring somebody home with you, whether you're dealing with somebody who is just the regular folk, or whether they're using some kind of drug that's going to make them nuts without any warning. And so it is very dangerous for guys. And that's something that's really kind of, like, everybody's talking about how it's not necessarily bad for women to assume they're in danger and be ready to bail on a date. But nobody considers that when it comes to guys. And what this kind of makes me think of is there's this movie, I cannot think of the stupid title. It had Adam Sandler and Drew Barrymore in it. Not
51st Dates?
It was not 51st. Okay. It's a recent movie. And Blended, my husband just told me. And it's, I think early in the movie, they were on a blind date together, and he bailed on her. And he got his friend to bail on her, you know, call him with, and he pretended he had to leave because there was an emergency. And she was just about to do it to him, but she was offended that he did it because, you know, the guy is not supposed to bail, right? Mm-hmm. And this is the kind of thing that we don't consider in our society. This is another area, you could say, of female privilege. Women are expected to bail on a date. Women are expected to, if they, you know, they can judge the guy and they're not pleased and they run off. Nobody's offended if they do that. If the guy's hurt, well, it's his problem. He should have been a better guy, right? But what happens if it's the other way around? What if somebody set up a system like this for guys? You know, women would just be crowing about what a horrible, evil thing this was, and how dare you make negative assumptions about women in general. And, you know, you could even call it men going their own way, because there's a similarity there towards this. You have to defend yourself by not just automatically trusting, which is a lot of what got MGTOW started. Mm-hmm. Was defending yourself by not automatically trusting. Women are horribly offended when you don't automatically trust them. It's why they hate MGTOW, you know, because they don't automatically trust women. And it's just the stark contrast between the expectation that this is not considered a bad thing when a woman does it, and to not just upfront say, look, this isn't working out, we're two different people, you know, and this isn't going to be a relationship, and I think we should just call it a night and try again with somebody else, you know, to not be able to have the balls to do that, you know, the expectation that women don't have to do that, turn it around and men do, that stark contrast is a definite area of female privilege and where men are at a disadvantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And no, for Hussein in the chat, MGTOW do not want to kill all women.
Oh, of course
not. That's stupid. There may be some people that have taken it to the degree where they believe that the corruption that happens with people when they are allowed to get away with everything, because women are the ones allowed to get away with everything, so they're the ones displaying the corruption. There are people that have developed the opinion that it's inherently female behavior. And that I'm seeing, and I understand the logic behind it, even though it's not correct. But that's the worst I've seen of MGTOW. I haven't seen him say kill all women, not MGTOW. I've seen people say it, but not MGTOW.
You know what though? If I might lighten the mood a bit though.
Sure.
I was just thinking like this could be the new age of dine and dash, but just for women. It's like, oh, you've just eaten the meal and the guy's being a little weird. You don't feel like picking up your part of the tab.
Yeah.
Can I get an angel shot, please?
Or you
dip the fuck out.
Or you know that you can just do this and you just go out on dates with guys, have them buy you your food, and then use it. Like, even if you don't think he's weird, just because you just wanted to eat and you didn't want to spend your own money.
Yeah, there you go.
And that's,
but like on a serious note though.
Yeah.
If I could be serious just for a second.
Yeah, sure,
Like this is not a bad idea inherently.
No.
I think the execution is probably a little bit clumsy. Like if anything, I would think that if there was a need for this, that maybe there would be like inside the women's bathroom, maybe they could go to the bathroom there and maybe there's a button they could press and then somebody can meet them in the bathroom. That way they could feel like they are in a safe area, you know, and then somebody could come in and escort them if there was legitimately a problem, you know. That might be a better way of doing it. I don't know. There's probably problems inherent within that.
Well, I mean, there are these things called phones, and you could like use yours while you're in the bathroom.
Well,
and call for help, right?
Yeah.
I know.
But there's all sorts of situations where that a phone might not be an option.
Yeah.
Possibly. Maybe you left it in a car, or you know, whatever it is.
No, I see what you're saying, but and then there are also situations where maybe men want to get out of these situations, and there's nothing for them. In this case, this is
right,
only for women.
Exactly.
So
there's no turn.
There's also that. No fair play. Yeah. And then in addition to that, I think that this can be abused to much more destructive ends rather than, you know, simply,
sure.
you know, taking advantage of a guy's money so you can get a free meal or, you know, being kind of like, I guess it can be pretty hurtful or rude if you... you know, found a guy to be really creepy, but you didn't have the balls to tell him that you didn't think it was working and that you should probably just end the date. But instead, she felt so fearful of you that she had to go through this sort of like extended process of ordering an angel shot, of which the guy may learn what that is. And, you know, he'll certainly learn when she's gone or when, you know, like the staff is basically like
wildfire.
Yeah. Or when the staff comes up to him and says, sorry, bro, your date's gone. And he's like, what, where did she go? And he's like, you don't follow her, bro, because we, you know, we heard that you were dangerous or you scared her or you did something to cause this. Right. Well, you know, that's
you scared whore.
Yeah. You scared that whore.
I heard that slip a bit. The Freudian slip, right?
No, I think I meant it, but you don't know. But you know what I'm saying? Like, there's that can get bad, but then it can get potentially worse than that. Like, you know, if you were a guy that went on a blind date and somebody angel shotted you or whatever you want to call it, you could be banned from going in. They may not want you back in anymore because they might deem that you're a dangerous individual. They could there could be a bunch of white knights that want to just kick your ass.
Yeah.
Without even knowing, you know, what
the fucking bouncers at the club.
Yeah.
You know, they fucking get the idea.
Because,
like, oh, this guy's fucking with this girl. Let's go show him what you're doing.
This guy's giving you trouble, man.
I've seen shit like that happen.
Especially if you, like, go with the lime and you basically get the cops to show up. And there's no, like, nobody's going to, this is the thing, too. No one questions it. There's no, like, well, why are you calling the police? Is this important? No, the police are going to show up, and the woman could say whatever she wanted. She could say, well, he threatened me or whatever, and then they'll arrest that guy and beat the shit out of him. So I'm saying this is essentially, this is something that I think came about with good intentions, but I think that it's going to cause problems. It's because there's going to inevitably be some psychotic bitch that uses this to hurt someone because she's obviously somewhat, like, there's a good chance that she's crazy if she can't find a date unless she's on Tinder. And, guys, just swipe left. I mean, just get the fuck out of there.
Oh, God.
But inevitably, this is going to end up hurting the wrong people. And I don't know if they're going to actually make a change or have to look at this again or if they're just going to let it happen.
Well, that's you know, concern. This is something, too, like, to kind of further emphasize the point that you're making is that I briefly skimmed over this story I saw this week, and it was about this girl who basically I can't remember the specifics, but she had made up a story about her father doing something to her, and he ended up going to jail for like 20 fucking years just on the implication that she said he had done something. I don't remember the specifics of it, but like this is that kind of situation where a woman can, you know, we've seen it, you know, God, a couple of years ago, this teenager got accused of raping a girl who he'd never fucking even gone out on a date with, but the girl said he did. And they were like going after this kid. He got fucking kicked out of school, all this other kind of stuff. It's just, the implication is enough. The implication is it's a fucking damn near a death sentence in a lot of cases. I mean, it'll fucking kill your career. It'll kill your schooling. You know, there's so many other things that can happen just because of the implication that somebody just said something. And just everything, you know, gotta listen and believe, gotta, you know, because fucking, you know, we have to, you know, we have to believe everything we're told because, yeah, that's how the law works, right? I don't know. I thought it was innocent until proven guilty, but, you know, not so much anymore. So, yeah, this is a very dangerous situation. There's a lot of fucked up things that could happen as a result of this, for sure.
I would say this too, guys. If you're on a date with a psychotic bitch and it's a blind date, you should, and you're at this restaurant, you should order her an angel shot to get her out of there. No, but I think that we've lost the art of being able to, like, just, you know, tell each other what our needs are, what our expectations are, when we're unhappy, when we're, you know, like, whatever our status is. Like, you're on a date with some... Look, if you're on a date with someone and she doesn't have the ability to be honest with and upfront with you about how she's feeling, you know, and maybe it'll actually give you the opportunity and her the opportunity to learn how rational that feeling is, then maybe you don't want to be dating her anyway. Because I certainly don't want to be involved with somebody that doesn't have the ability to tell me what she's feeling or what she's thinking or whatever at any given moment, you know? Right. And that's like cowardice. And I can't stand that. So, but yeah, I am concerned that there could be some exploitative stuff. And this is basically just the white knighting taken to like the level of like, you know, an entire business basically. So, right. And go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, this restaurant is located in Florida, right?
Yeah.
I was thinking...
Hopefully not near a gay bar.
Yeah. Oh, jeez. Well, no, what I was going to suggest is that maybe all four of us should form an 80s band, and we should call it Angel Shot, and then we should go and perform at this bar, see what happens.
Yeah, that's funny. They'll probably have the police drag us off the stage. Just because
and we should play Still the Night by Whitesnake and really trigger all the feminists.
Oh, yeah, boy. Do some Nightsnake covers. Or Whitesnake, not Nightsnake?
Nightsnake. That sounds rapey.
No. We're going to show up the Nightsnake after the set, okay?
Giggity.
After
we can play.
You know, there is whatever words you put together to make a band name, there's probably already a band with that name by now. With the number of garage bands that there are out there, you probably could take any two random words from the dictionary and it's a band name somewhere.
Not my band.
There's probably a band name called a band name. So.
Yeah. Well, I think if I was going to have a band, I would call it Your Mom. And then whenever anybody, you know, oh, I'm going to go to a concert. Who are you going to go see? Your Mom.
You know what? Nightsnake is actually a tribute band for Whitesnake.
I'm surprised.
There you go.
Are they like a bunch of black guys? I'm kidding. Okay, so
I have no idea. I'm That'd be Alabama Black Snake, I believe, is what the common parlance is.
Moving on. All right, final story. I don't have a write-up for this one because it's so good. It doesn't need – it's the Age of Shitlords already did a great job with this one. So,
yeah.
Marvel's latest feminist cringe comic, The Unstoppable Wasp. About a week ago, we published an article, we as in Age of Shitlords, about how Marvel Comics had swallowed the feminist Kool-Aid and turned most of their comics into annoying feminist fan fictions with cringe-worthy dialogues and really bad drawings. Most of the comics, like Mockingbird, had to be canceled due to underperforming sales and poor reception from comic book fans. Marvel must have not learned their lesson, because their latest comic is several million degrees of insanity worse than all the previous ones. The Unstoppable Wasp is a 2017 comic book written by Jeremy Whitler, which follows the story of an unstoppable genius hero girl named Nadia. Nadia is described...
Wait, where have we heard this before, Brian?
This is like all of them.
It was 2 weeks ago when it was Riri Williams was the unstoppable yes. Iron... super science teenager,
but it was also before that
Squirrel Girl is unstoppable super science person teenager girl
girl
whatever,
and then Mockingbird was rewritten as like an unstoppable science girl, and also there was Moon Girl, who was basically when they rebooted the Devil Dinosaur comic, and they took the sidekick who used to be like this prehistoric boy, like chimp boy, and he was called Moon Boy, and they replaced him with a little black girl, which I'm not really sure that was the wisest move. They also said she was the smartest character in the Marvel universe. It's always changing.
She's the super sciencey teenage girl now. Yeah. This is so weird. They keep beating that same fucking drum. It's almost as if they've run out of fucking ideas.
Almost.
So weird. Almost exactly like that.
Unstoppable genius girl hero named Nadia. Nadia is described as a teenage super scientist who wants to change the world. Right after she gains U.S. citizenship, brace yourself for unwanted opinions on immigration in future releases. Unsolicited opinions on immigration. The first issue of the book was released on January 4th, and I managed to get my hands on a copy of it for the purpose of writing this article. If you are reading this, you owe me reparations for the amount of cancer that I had to endure reading this comic. Just in case you don't know what kind of idiocy to expect from the comic, here's a recent tweet that I pulled from the Twitter account of the guy who wrote it. Quote, by Jeremy Whitley. I think my favorite thing in a review so far was when somebody noted there were only two men in the first issue of Unstoppable Wasp. So the fact that it was basically mostly women in the book is good. This is equality, guys. The comic begins with Nadia visiting the immigration office to apply for U.S. citizenship, where she tells the immigration officer that her life story. She is apparently the long-separated daughter of Ant-Man, who was stolen from him before her birth. The Ant-Man's pregnant wife was captured by unknown villains who kept her in a secret facility in Russia called the Red Room. This is the place where the hackers live, apparently. Where she gave birth to Nadia. Nadia was trained as an assassin and lived her whole life in captivity until she made a daring escape and moved to the U.S. This sounds like a fan fiction.
Why is it always an assassin?
Super science hero girl trained as an assassin as she was separated from her father and birthed from her mother in a Russian super assassin...
Gulag Red Room place.
Well, everybody knows that all the best assassins come from Russia.
Yeah, apparently.
Well, I mean, yeah.
Before she could complete her story to the immigration officer or sign her immigration papers, she and her friend Ms. Marvel hear a commotion outside. Mockingbird, yes, the same Mockingbird whose comic was canceled, is fighting a giant robot outside, and Nadia and Ms. Marvel go help. So there's just a robot attacking the city for no fucking reason. It's like Power Girls starts off that way. The dialogue that takes place when the three superheroines meet sounds like what happens when an 80-year-old man tries desperately to appear modern and hipstery. With references to Harry Potter and Star Wars, this scene is a classic example of how do you do, fellow kids? And they have some pages.
This is Big Bang Theory. This is Big Bang Theory in comics form. This is like, hey, let's throw a bunch of, you know, pop culture references into the script, and they don't really make any sense, and they're not really kind of they're just a disjointed word salad basically. But people just laugh because you said Voltron. Oh God, Voltron! I remember Voltron.
I know. God. Oh my God, they know the things that I know. I feel like I know them so well. We're so close.
Oh, we're such huge nerds.
I want to shoot too.
It's inked with member berry juice, in other words.
Yes, it is.
Seriously. Well, I would say it's more stained with member berry juice, but yeah, you could go with inked as well.
The comic is so bad that even the villain is a feminist moron. After the Wasp shrinks herself and infiltrates the robot's exterior, she finds out that the suit is being operated by a famous biochemist, another super sciencey girl, named Monica Rapacine, or Rapacine, I don't know how you say it, whatever, who Nadia used to adore. Nadia voices her disappointment at the fact that a childhood hero of hers has become a supervillain. How does the super evil female super smart scientist respond? She complains about female scientists' representation and how only male blowhard scientists have become famous.
Let me stop you right there real quick. The fact that she's crying about fucking scientists being famous, you're doing your fucking job wrong if that's what you're doing to get famous. You're fucking,
And I'm going to build a robot and attack the city. That's my
answer. Because I'm not famous for doing science. Get the fuck. Oh, my God.
So dumb.
It's so contrived. It's so dumb.
No, it really is. It really is. And there was even... I want to check something here because... Okay, we're still streaming. I noticed the chat stopped for some reason, but the stream is still going. When she... Well, I'm not getting any, but whatever. When she finds out who that person is, the literal line that she uses... where Wasp says, and when she realizes that someone she, you know, liked was a supervillain, she said, "Wait, you became a supervillain?" Now, I hate when I hear that shit in comics, because that's not, like, that's so fourth wall breaking. It's a really lame thing to say, to actually have characters acknowledge that supervillain is like a concept, you know, that just irritates the shit out of me. But then she says, "That's super disappointing. Your biochemistry work was revolutionary." So they end up having a discussion. If that was a dude in there, she would have just knocked him out. But because it's a woman, she wants to understand why she became evil. And then when she does, it's almost like she sympathizes with it. That's... I don't know. In another scene, Mockingbird and the Wasp are back at the Wasp apartment and talking about the list. According to Mockingbird, S.H.I.E.L.D. created a list of the smartest people in the planet, and the highest-ranking woman on the list is in the 27th position. This pisses her off for some reason. I did a bit of research, and it turns out the list being referred to in this comic literally does not exist. No Marvel animation, comic book, film, or anything has ever made mention of a list of the most intelligent people on the planet, which means that the writer of this comic invented the concept of the list all by himself, just so his characters can have something to bitch about. Hilariously, this non-existent list is basically what the entire comic book is about. After learning about the list and how unfairly represented women are on it, Nadia decides to dedicate her entire life to getting to the top of the list. "I'm going to make them rethink that whole list," she thought to herself. The end. If this comic is not canceled in the next 2 years, I'm going to be very disappointed in the human race.
I'll be surprised if it makes it past 8 issues.
Yeah.
So inventing a non-existent list to be the basis for an entire comic series that is about bitching about the non-existent, that's totally feminist. Yeah. That is the most feminist thing I have heard so far in comics.
Yeah.
Creating something that does not exist, making up something that really, to be honest, it would not actually be a discriminatory thing, and it wouldn't actually be something to bitch about if it did exist, but creating something that is artificially to bitch about, you know, for the reason to bitch about is artificial, and the thing itself is also artificial, man-spreading, that is the most feminist thing. This guy has successfully created a totally feminist comic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But is it story, but is it robust?
He's a self-flagellating, you know, man hating. He hates himself. He hates the fact that he has a penis, that he is burdened with masculine toxicity.
And it can't be robust because robust has bust in it, and bust is sexist.
Oh, fucking hell. I love it. I love you, Hannah.
I love you, too.
This is so painful.
It really is. You know, the funny thing is, it's like, I went and actually found this online and read it, because, you know, you can do that if you look around on the internet machine long enough. And, right? This really is just, you know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of, remember the movie Short Circuit with Johnny Five?
Yeah. Johnny Five, that's Alive.
This reminded me of Johnny Five. It's like, she's like, you know, they go to a donut shop, and he's like, what are these? These are donuts, oh! You know, and I'm like reading this thing in Johnny Five's voice basically the whole time when I was reading it. Mm-hmm. And just the book is, okay, here's the thing. I'm going to be devil's advocate here for a second. This book isn't as bad as Angela, Queen of Hell, which was the unsolicited opinions on Israel shit.
Yeah, yeah.
That, holy fucking shit, that is a terribly written book. That is like really, really bad. This at least has some points where it's, you know, somewhat quaint and positive, and maybe it's putting out a good message, but it's so fucking contrived.
Yeah, it's really cringy.
No, it really is.
But this is the thing I find, I'm surprised that more people aren't insulted by how bad this is. And I'm not saying I'm outraged in the same way the feminists are outraged. I'm more really disappointed, but I'm going to explain why. Yeah. When I criticize this book, because I've seen the panel where someone shared the page where they're like fighting the robot and talking about like Star Wars references or whatever right? And it's really annoying and cringy. But I'm talking about this, and there are people who are asking me, they were like, but this comic is probably aimed at a young audience of young girls. Right. So if it was, wouldn't that explain why it was written the way it was? And I thought to myself, well, I asked them, I said, no, let's look it up. You know, it's 12 and up, just like most Marvel comics, okay? But if it is targeting girls as an audience, which I wouldn't be surprised if that was the intended audience, because then what you're saying is that when you make a book for a 12-year-old boy and when you make a book for a 12-year-old girl, you are literally writing like they're 6 years old in order to get girls interested. That you think that what you got to do is you got to treat girls like they're way younger than 12. Meanwhile, you can expose boys to themes that are basically on par with an average PG-13 film. You can even have some language. You can have, you know, just like darker, grittier themes in boys' books, but with girls' books you can't. You gotta do this like kind of Big Bang Theory, Joss Whedon nerd reference shit, and do it in like a really tongue-in-cheek way. Like, we're aware that we're in a comic book because I'm using terms like supervillain, and you know, and we're gonna talk about pop culture because it's like I'm living in the same world as you, and we're all nerdy girls. You know, not only are we super intelligent, super powerful, badass, super genius science chicks, but we're also awkward and nerdy and just like you, fellow reader. We're just like you. And it's so infantilizing. It's so infantilizing to girls if you're writing for girls in this way. This is terrible. Yeah. I'm sure that Mockingbird was just as bad because I read it. I read through as much as I could for one of our shows, and lots of other books that are aimed at a female audience that I wouldn't even limit it to what Marvel's putting out. But because I'm seeing that, like Batgirl, when they rebooted her back in the a few years ago, and they were like, she's in college and she takes selfies and look, her costume looks like it was made at home, just like a cosplayer would. Look, girls, just like you. That's just why
it's like a really good word for it. It is infantilizing. It's pandering and it's cloying and it's saccharine is what it is. Like, you know what? If I was a girl and I was like, honestly, if I was a girl and I read this story, I would feel like somebody was talking down to me, that they were condescending to me.
I mean, you'd probably...
It's too easy. It's too... Like I said, it's saccharine, I think, is the best way to describe it. Because
It's cringy.
It's patronizing.
That's really what they've asked for, though. That's what these social justice types, these special snowflakes have asked for. I mean, think back to the story on the professors. This is what they have basically said. If you don't dumb it down for me, and you don't put it in my particular language, and my particular language has to be limited to my existing life experience because I'm not smart enough to learn anything outside my existing life experience, then you're not making it for me. It's not. I can't be included in the audience that it's made for. Mm-hmm. And this is where they are. This is where social justice has taken people. The idea that they are not smart enough and not strong enough, not tough enough, not resilient enough to engage with anything that is beyond the experience they have already had. They can't have new things. Nothing can be new to them, because then it's scary and crazy and insulting and upsetting and damaging, or they just can't understand it. They've created the ultimate safe space in their own heads.
Yeah. And to put a finer point on this is that when you look at, and I'm not saying this is the way it is across the board at Marvel, but when you look at other Marvel books, there are a lot of books that are suffering from this that are not specifically focused towards girls. The editorial staffs and the people that are doing the writing over at Marvel right now, the predominant, you know, theme is to do a lot of this kind of really, like I was saying, this very saccharine, you know, feminist kind of narrative type stuff. And it's not good. It's not good across the board.
It's incredibly dumbed down. I actually worry that it might be like a bit on the, well, I'm worried that it's trying to essentially infect girl readers by treating them this way. It's like, I think that there are people with bad ideas making products specifically to spread those bad ideas. And
absolutely.
That's what I think that this book is another example of. And the reason why is because, like, if you're interested in having, like, you know, representation of really good female characters, the Wasp, not this one, because this is not Janet Van Dyne, this is her daughter. When I was reading comics in the 80s...
Or no, this isn't Janet's daughter. She's the daughter of the person.
Henry Pym's daughter. Sorry. Well, she's Ant-Man's daughter.
Henry Pym's daughter, yes.
Ant-Man is what they said, so I don't know if that's Scott Lang or Pym, but whatever.
Yeah, when no, it was I was Pym reading... and then there was some other woman in some other place. So,
okay.
Yeah, anyway, just wanted to clarify.
So, no, it's okay. So, in the 80s, when I was reading comics, when I was really into it and I was collecting them and stuff, I was really a big fan of the Avengers comics. I love the artwork in them. I can't remember the guy that was doing it. But he had like a Neil Adams style. It might have been him, but I'm not sure. Anywho, the leader of that team at that time, and this was the arc where Baron Zemo takes over the mansion and he brings the Masters of Evil, and it's a really good series, lots of action, a lot of fun to read. When, at that time, the Wasp, Janet Van Dyne, was the leader of the Avengers, and because they were always changing their rosters around, but they were also changing leadership around, right? And it was, I loved that character. I thought she was really cool and interesting. And I didn't really think about it like, oh, my God, a woman, it's so great. Or, oh, my God, a woman, that's gross. I was just like, oh, the Wasp is cool. I like the costume and, you know, I dig the character. I like the haircut. I like the design. I thought she was, she was just good.
Yeah, it wasn't about her being a woman. It was about her being an effective leader is what it was.
Yeah, she earned it. She was cool for that. Yeah, there was another female character on the same team that was named, her name at the time was Captain Marvel, but I think today they call her Photon or something. And she, Monica.
But the same thing with Storm, because
Monica
it was happening
Rambeau.
At the same time in the X-Men.
Yeah, exactly. The thing is.
And it wasn't about her being a woman, it was about her being an effective leader.
Yeah, she was so basically, it was more of an individualist approach to writing characters, because they did not represent their gender, their sexual orientation, their race, none of those things. North Star from the Alpha Flight, he had been gay for a long time. Most comic readers didn't give a shit.
He'd been hinted at. Most, I think most people knew if you followed the comics.
Yeah, like, so I'm saying.
Most,
if like, they didn't,
the average
but,
person didn't know until they came out and made a big spectacle.
Right. Like, they didn't make like the coming out issue, you better accept it, you bigot, or else. They just had him come out in the writing, and people were like, oh, all right, well, I kind of knew it. Like, that was, you know, most people's reaction. Oh, yeah, I figured as much.
It was
about the writing and the stories, but these, they're not about that. They're badly written. They're badly drawn. The stories suck. No, it's like no one knows what they're doing when they're making this shit. So this is just another in a long line of problems that's going to result in more of a dip of sales. And I'm just like, do you guys want to sink yourselves? Because this is what you're doing. You know,
you know what's funny about this too, though? The thing that's really kind of odd to me that's very curious about this is that you look at what Marvel is doing with their movie universe and how Kevin Feige or however the fuck you say his name. Kevin, what's his nuts?
Feige.
We'll call him that.
No, it's pronounced Feige.
He has got a very strong focus on where the movie universe is headed.
They've got a very, he's got a very strong editorial hand in that franchise.
Yeah.
But you look at the fucking comics, though, and it's a goddamn mess.
Yeah.
It's, you know, they fucking hired, what's her nuts, Lindy West. Oh, with her fucking unsolicited opinions on Israel.
Lindy West, yeah.
They've hired Dan Slott, who's turned into this ultra-feminist fucking cuckold.
Yeah. Fucking, who's the, you've got, who's the guy that they had writing Captain America that basically was like a political commentator who hated this country, and he was like, I want to make him a Nazi. You know, and
I
just
don't remember his name, but I can see his face in my head, though. The, I know
the,
you're talking
the guy literally was like, I'd like to talk about politics, but I have to write comics because I suck, so I'm going to use them as a platform to basically throw, you know, just take a shit all over it, basically, you know.
And that's kind of like something, you know, something I've talked about before is that what we're looking at right now is we're looking at a group of people that have an agenda to push. They can't – the agenda doesn't stand on its own. So what they have to do is they have to get into positions like into Marvel Comics, into DC Comics, wherever they are, so that they can attach their position onto something that is an already established property, so that they can piggyback their fucking bullshit politics onto something that is already profitable. It's already big. It's already being seen. It's Spider-Man. It's Captain America. It's the fucking Avengers. It's whatever it is. You know, it's like we're going to force our shit into that because otherwise our message can't get out there. And frankly, I'll be shocked. I'll be really, really shocked if Marvel doesn't fucking half their publishing schedule within the next year and a half. I mean, I will be shocked if they don't. I mean, they're gonna have to make some drastic changes because their numbers are in the fucking toilet. People are abandoning them left and right, and it's because these books. It's because books like this that are not well written. They're insulting. They're condescending. They're poorly written. You know, there's just not any strong editorial voice that is actually stepping up and saying, you know what we're doing right now is not good for the company's longevity. It's like, we think we're gaining new followers because we're, you know, hey girls, look, Marvel, you know, Marvel. Hey girls, look, you know, science, teenage science girl, you know, love us. It's like, come on, dude, that's not, you know, you can have those stories, but write them in a way that's not condescending. That's not, you know, pandering and saccharine.
Just get some
stupid
talent. Stop doing this divisive shit, you know, like all this whole, like, we're going to finally bring you a product that is, you know, insert identity politics agenda here. Don't do that. Just tell us two good stories. Word to the wise guys. It's like, don't do that.
Well, they just remember, here's DVID22 has pointed out this out. Marvel is owned by Disney. Mm-hmm. Are they not?
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
So Disney's bankrolling this. So I'm gonna say it. Disney does have social justice-y leanings and social justice-y goals. That is the area, the art community and the performance community is the area where these people all end up, because it's the only place they can really survive. If you have to, you know, if you have to be tough and strong and produce things consistently, like all the time, that are great. You know, if you have to produce things that work, and you can't make mistakes in your work, you can't have leeway, you know, in your work. They don't go into that. They don't go into areas of construction and science and stuff like that, where a mistake can be deadly. You know, so this is where they are, and. Yes, they're making a lot of money from some things, and yes, they are going to do things just to make money. But with Disney bankrolling this, if they decide they want to keep it this way, they will, and it won't matter whether it's profitable or not. I mean, look at some of the stuff that they're putting on television. They'll have one thing that makes a lot of money and a bunch of garbage that nobody wants to watch. And the one thing that makes a lot of money supports the garbage.
Well, here to be devil's advocate to that, though, Joe Quesada, who's actually the CEO and head, you know, head editorial guy at Marvel, he basically runs the comics division. Somebody actually asked him about the involvement within Disney and how much that affects Marvel, and apparently they have kept Disney has kept, according to him. I mean, granted, this could have just been lip service, but. According to him, Disney has kept their hands completely off the editorial process when it comes to Marvel. So this is a failing of Joe Quesada and the people that he has hired as editors for the respective books that we're talking about now. So there's that. Take take that with a grain of salt, you know.
But, yeah, I was going to say, I wouldn't be surprised if the direction has changed, though, in part because they are with a company that has more of a social justice leaning.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I'm not saying it's not possible, but that's just according to what he has said. Again, it could just be lip service, but yeah.
Well, actually, I'm as an aside, I'm actually concerned that even the cinematic universe is going to start going in this direction.
So far they've been
okay. You know? They've been okay. Yeah. Like, I mean, pretty good, with a couple of hiccups. Like some of the stuff that some of the things that Joss Whedon did with his Avengers films annoyed me a little bit, but it wasn't like, oh my god, you know, I still love those movies. I thought they were great. Wasn't egregious, but I was kind of like, okay, yeah. Dude, you can tone that down, you know. She's just an assassin from Russia. She shouldn't be doing the shit that the super soldier is doing. And then there's like the, you know, the other stuff, like Agent Carter, which had to get canceled because it was probably because it was way too feminist. And Jessica Jones was a bit annoying. Oh, and Luke Cage was kind of annoying too, and had like some social justice-y shit. Even though in the minds of many people who were reviewing it that were like social justice warriors themselves, they didn't think it was social justice-y enough. So that means that if they would have had their hand in it, it would have been extremely bad. So I'm not saying it's a problem.
Some reason I always forget about the Netflix stuff.
Yeah, the Netflix stuff is a little... The Daredevil's awesome, but that's because you have a white guy, so nobody needs to like put any agenda shit in there. They can just tell a good story. This is what I'm saying. Listen, you know? This is what I think the ultimate test is going to come down to, is when they make their Captain Marvel movie, the one with the female lead, be the one that basically sets the tone. For how bad they're going to get. Because that's either... If they just tell a good story, it's going to be great. But if they go down this fucking roll, this shithole right here of feminist pandering, it's going to be a shit movie. I can tell you that right now. So, anyway.
I want to point out, I'm not saying things are hopeless either. I do expect them to go this route. And I do think that is the reason. And they do have the money to bankroll it, and they will. But they're also going to know when something is a waste of time. And propaganda that people don't have to look at, it is a waste of time to a degree, especially if it's such blatant propaganda that it's no longer entertaining. People just won't bother looking at it. It doesn't meet its goal because it doesn't convince anybody of anything. And that they'll eventually get to a point where they're saying, this is a waste of time, this is a waste of resources, we aren't achieving anything with this. So we still have that method of sort of voting with our wallets on what we want to see coming out of this company. That they don't blatantly propagandize everything.
Yeah. All right. Well, I want to thank you guys for joining up. And we're going to wrap up the show because we're going to read the comic, The Unstoppable Wasp, in the post show. Let's see how far we get into it before we all have to go to the bathroom and throw up. So,
bleach our eyes.
Yeah, and bleach and bleach out your eyeballs. So I want to thank Max and for the write-ups and for coming on, and also Scott and Hannah for joining me on the Polecat, and the people who wrote up, Arweg, Mike J, and my stapler for helping out with some of the write-ups. And I want to thank Feminism for giving me something to talk about every week. So,
thanks for keeping it interesting.
Yes, thank you for giving me material that I can point at and say this is a thing that exists. So with that, we're going to leave you guys off, and that we are done with the Polecat for today. We'll see you on Thursday, where we go more into the trial, and the proceedings, and where we go from here at Honey Badger Brigade versus the Mary Sue and the Calgary Expo. So, this is Brian signing out. We'll talk to you.